let us start right away. Before we start, let me ask a question. How many of you invest in bank FDs? Please vote on your screens. The poll must be visible on your screens. Please vote on your screens. Okay, so I think clearly about 75% of the people are investing in bank fixed deposit. Let me ask you another question. How many of you have invested in debt mutual funds? You can see the poll on your screens. Please vote. I'm awaiting the vote from everyone. Okay, so not everybody. I think we have a we have an answer that is about 60%, 57% of the people haven't invested. Only 43% of the people have invested in a debt mutual fund, and I think possibly we will see if that can, that figure will probably change at the end of the end of this webinar. So a quick beginning and just a few ground rules. Please feel free to raise your hands. If you ask any questions, I will be able to see it when you raise your hands. You can ask for the you can raise your hand, you can ask questions on the chat, and I will also give you an opportunity to ask the question on voice, or you can ask the question on the chat. So a quick primer on debt mutual funds. I think as the name implies, a debt mutual fund invests in debt instruments. The type of debt funds, one are pure debt funds. Those are mutual funds that will invest only in debt instruments. Then there are hybrid debt funds that invest in a mix of debt and equity in varying proportions. So you have what are popularly called monthly income plans that will invest anywhere between 65 to 80% of the fund amount in debt and about 15 to 25% in equity, versus you have what are popularly called balanced funds, where 65 to 80% is in equity and only 20 to 30% is in debt. So hybrid debt funds can be many. As far as this webinar is concerned, we are only talking of pure debt mutual funds. We are not really talking of hybrid funds. Hybrid funds have their own advantages, but that I think is the subject matter of probably another webinar. Among the pure debt funds, I think we can, okay, we have a question here. It says, the board is not visible. Okay, is the board visible? Please chat. This is not a poll, so I cannot administer it. Please chat and tell me if the if you are able to. Please let me know if you are able to see the presentation. Is everybody able to see the presentation? Some of you can please chat with me and tell me if you are able to see the presentation. Okay, I think I have a couple of answers here. Yes. Okay. Some people can't see the slides. Some people can. Okay. Okay. Let me see if okay, are you able to? I think you will be able to see the screen now. Okay, so let's talk of the short-term funds. In short-term funds, you typically have liquid funds and what are called ultra-short-term funds. Typically, liquid funds are funds that don't invest in anything, any product that has more than 90 days out due. An ultra short-term fund will also invest in certain portion in up to 180 days. Essentially, money market instruments like treasury bills, CPs, commercial paper, CDs, short-term corporate deposits, etc., or treasury bills with maturity not exceeding 90 days or 180 days. Then we have what are called income or bond funds. As the name implies, bond funds invest typically in government securities, and income fund will also invest in other debt instruments other than government securities. In both cases, the funds invest some portion significantly in a longer term instrument. They could be corporate or government bonds, they could be treasury bills, they could obviously the bond funds invest, the gilt funds, they are popularly called gilt funds, they invest only in government bonds. The highly rated funds, there are funds that are rated and they by definition invest only in AAA rated instruments. You can also find out whether a fund, what is the proportion of the fund, what is the rating of the instruments that are invested in by the fund. There are various places where you can get this information. There are sites like Value Research, there are sites like Morningstar, where you can get information on the average rating of the instruments in any income or a bond fund. Then there are bond funds can again be of three varieties. There are long-term bond funds, as the name implies, they invest a larger proportion in bonds of higher maturity. Average maturity can probably be as high as 6, 7 or even 8 years. Then there are short-term bond funds which, as the name implies, invest in bonds of maybe with an average maturity of 1 or 2 years. And there are dynamic bond funds. In the dynamic bond funds, the manager proactively decides, depending on what he thinks the market is going to be, he might move from shorter term tenure bonds to longer tenure bonds, or from longer tenure bonds to shorter tenure bonds. The average maturity of the bonds in the case of a dynamic bond can vary quite significantly from time to time. So why we started off this webinar about by saying that debt mutual funds are better than bank fixed deposits. And here is a quick and a slightly simplified explanation on why that is so. I think returns, if you look at the returns from a debt mutual fund, they are equal to or better than bank FDs of the same duration. If you look up on June 30th, 2013, bank FDs typically, and we picked up SBI as the nominee for bank FDs, clearly it is the largest bank in India, the safest bank in India. For 180 days, the interest rate on an FD for 180 days was around 7.5%. For 1 year was 9, for 3 years also was around 9, 8.75 to 9. A debt mutual fund gave returns of, and we picked up the somewhere in the index, the typical index is the CRISIL liquid fund index. The CRISIL liquid fund index for 180 days was around 8.2%, for 180 days was 10.50% for a year, and 8.5% for 3 years. What you therefore see is that the pre-tax returns are similar or better for debt mutual funds. You can see that, right? You can see that if for 180 days, for 1 year, even for 3 years, although it is slightly lower, it's very, very similar. The magic really, I think, is in the tax efficiency of the mutual funds. And we are going to show an example how even a similar pre-tax return, the returns are not very different from a fixed deposit versus a debt mutual fund, but the tax efficiency of the mutual fund makes the post-tax return on debt mutual funds really be a winner, where as compared to fixed deposits are concerned. And for our examples, we have really chosen people whose tax rates are high at 30%. So this is a simple example. Let's take the example. I hope you can see this. Please, anybody who can't see this, please chat with me and tell me that whether or not you can see this. Do let me know if you can or cannot see this. The interest earned is, let us assume that both for the debt and the bank FD, the interest earned is the same. It is at 10%. We are not assuming a different interest rate. So if you invested 1 lakh in the beginning, and let us say we are talking of a 2-year FD. We are talking of a 2-year FD, right? So we invested in the beginning 1 lakh. The interest earned and credited in year 1, in both cases obviously will be 10,000, which makes it 1,10,000. Now in a bank FD, interest TDS is deducted at 10%, so 1000 rupee will be deducted. What will be left is 1,10,000 in the debt fund and 1,09,000 in the FD. You will earn interest on the second year at again 10%, so now it's 10% of 1,10,000, which is 11,000, and so total 121 in the debt fund. Here, because your investment has come down to 109, your return at 10% comes down to 10,900 as compared to this at 11, and therefore your investment cumulative value becomes 1,19,900, from which you pay 10% TDS, and therefore net value from the investment is 1,18,810 as compared to 1,21,000 for the debt fund. We've tried to simplify this. I hope this is understandable. Please tell me if I'm open to questions before I go further. Okay. Just because TDS is deducted doesn't mean that you don't have to pay tax on the interest income, and just because TDS is not deducted from the debt fund, it doesn't mean that you don't have to pay tax. The difference is, in the debt mutual fund, you will pay tax only when you redeem it, which is at the end of 2 years, and the maximum tax is 10%. I have ignored the education cess just for ease of calculation, just maybe 10, 20, 30. So essentially, because total interest earned was 21,000, at 10%, your long-term capital gain was 2,100. Net money left with you after paying taxes is 1,18,900. That is 1,21,000 minus 2,100. In a fixed deposit, you'll have to pay tax every year. In the first year, 1,000 rupees was tax deducted, but since your tax rate is 30%, another 2,000 you'll have to pay as advance tax. Similarly, in the next year, although 1,090 is deducted, 2,180, which is 20% of 10,900, you'll have to pay as income tax. Net-net, total tax you will have to pay in the case of a bank FD is 4,180. this is over and above the TDS, which means now what you are left with after paying taxes is about 1,14,630 as compared to 1,18,900. Or essentially what you make post-tax more is about 4,270 or 4.27% of your original investment you make extra. This magic, even when the pre-tax return is the same at 10%, the magic here is that you pay tax only at 10%. In fact, there is an alternative calculation as well, which depends on the weighted capital gains, and then you pay tax on the balance amount at 20%. We have ignored that because this is the maximum you have to pay. So even at maximum, you still make a lot more, you have to still pay a lot less tax, and therefore you'll be left with more of the income. Clearly, I think this particular thing is the key to the benefits of investing in a debt mutual fund. Please do ask me questions at this time before we move on to the next question, before we move on to some of the other things that are relevant for a debt mutual fund. Yes, please go ahead. Hello. Please go ahead and ask me any questions that you might have at this point of time. You can use the chat window. If there is anything that you want to understand about this working, anything that you have not understood, please tell me. There seems to be some question. Yes. There's a question here. It says, is the TDS deducted by debt fund at the time of redemption? No, there is no TDS on debt fund. I'm assuming I'm talking to a resident Indian here. As long as the investor is a resident Indian, there is no TDS. The debt fund doesn't deduct any TDS at all. Suppose the investor is non-tax payee, will he still benefit investing in a debt fund? If he is a non-tax payee and he is making, then the benefit will not be much there. I think that is a question that I cannot see the name, but that's a question. No, so if you are not a high tax payee, the benefit is much less, since the major benefit is because the tax rate, effective tax rate that you pay on the interest income in a debt mutual fund is lower than what you would pay in a bank FD. Isn't the risk higher with debt funds? Lovely question. I think that is the question has been asked by, I cannot see the name. But I will answer that. That's the risk part is covered somewhere later. Are the returns market driven like equity MF and unlike bank FDs? Again, an excellent question. I think again, it is covered in the later slides. Fine. I think, but have people really understood this calculation? Was this calculation understandable? If you have any questions on the calculation itself at this point, I will answer that, or I think let me move on. I think people have already raised the fact that debt mutual funds can lead to losses sometimes, and let me ask this poll. I think About 43% of the people have invested in debt funds. Let me ask them. So please answer this poll only if you have invested in debt funds. Have you suffered losses in debt mutual funds in July 2013? In July 2013, as you know, RBI came out with some shock announcements which were the market was not expecting, and therefore even liquid funds, the NAVs went down, and clearly I think that was very, very unexpected. So let me just see how many people. So I think clearly yes, I think a lot of people have suffered losses, and I think a valid question would be if that was so, that if I have suffered losses, why is it that we are talking about still saying that debt mutual funds are better? So let's examine this a little more. Do I see some questions here? Okay, not too many questions. Okay, a simple explanation of the reason why the loss occurs. I think we see in television that when interest rates rise, bond prices will fall. When interest rates drop, bond prices will increase. I've tried to give a very simplified explanation of why that happens. So let's take that same example that we saw. Maturity value of the debt mutual fund at the end of 2 years, assuming investment of 1 lakh at 10% per annum, was, if you remember, 1,21,000. And how did we arrive at that 121? The first year it was principal of 1 lakh plus interest of 10,000, totaling to 1,10,000. At the end of 1 year, it totaled to 110. On that principal of 110 plus interest of 11,000, you totally got 121. So if nothing happened, then your 1 lakh investment in a debt mutual fund at 10% income would have become 1,21,000. So how does the loss occur and why did the loss occur? Now let's assume that the return expectation, so this is what changed. Scenario 2, what has changed is that at the end of year 1, the return, and I've given very sharp examples to bring out the why this works the way it works. Suppose the return expectation in the market changed from 10% to 15%. Now obviously, if you want to sell your mutual fund, nobody is going to buy because they know that at the end of 1 year he is going to get 1,21,000. Although what has been accumulated is 110, nobody is going to buy it at 110. How much is he going to buy it at? I think you will need to do a reverse calculation. You know that at the end of year 2, you are going to get 1,21,000. If my return expectation is 15%, the value works out to 1,05,217. This is a reverse calculation. 1,05,217 into 1.15, if you do that math, it will be 1,21,000, which means even though the value accumulated in the fund is 1,10,000, if you sell it, you will be able to sell it only at 1,05,217, or in other words, at a loss of 4,783. I've tried to simplify this, but how can you avoid these notional losses? Now the same example, if you sell, this is the loss you incur, but if you hold on till maturity, what happens? At the end of year 2, you get 1,21,000. So what has happened? In the first year, your return dropped to 5.21. At 1 lakh, your NAV was 1,05,000 and not 1,10,000. So you got a return of only 5.21%, but on the next year your return was 15%, and the average return is 10%, which is what you expected in the first place. What that means is that if you continue to hold on after the shock event happened at the end of year one. If you continue to hold on, then eventually your average return will be what you had expected. Was that? So somebody asked me, what is return expectation? Return. So when you put money in a bank FD, obviously you expect a certain return. Now that return expectation is dependent on many factors and it keeps changing from time to time. So those of you who invested say 2-3 years ago, clearly our return expectation was lower, say in 2011, then it has gradually dropped and then it has now increased over the last 1.5-2 months. Okay, so if you continue to hold on, I think that's what we showed in that example, that instead of selling it at 1,05,217, if you continue to hold on, you got 1,21,000. So which means that you got on an average 10%. So even though in the middle of the year, your return was only 5.21, but if you continue to hold on to it, the next 1 year you got a return of 15%, which averaged out to 10%. Now that was true of a what is called as a fixed maturity plan. You knew at the end of 2 years you will get the money back. What happens in funds that are normally open-ended, which means you never redeem, you have to give it back to the fund. So let's take a quick liquid fund example. Even liquid funds, people have incurred losses, and we have picked up the CRISIL liquid fund index. Okay. Now if you took that a 90-day period from April 24 to July 24, the reason we have picked up July 24th is that that was the second shock date where the RBI gave the second shock. And now when you started your investment in April 24, the 90-day CRISIL index was at 8%, which means you would have expected to make 8% over 90 days. But what happened? Because of the shock, your return as on July 24, the NAVs dropped, your return was only 6%. Now the loss was of loss of income, not loss of capital. But after, if you continued to hold on from July 24th onwards, because the index increased dramatically, it is at 12% since July 24th, the index, not every fund has mimicked the index. So not every fund dropped to 6%, but the index itself was increasing at 12%. If you held on to the liquid fund till August 8, which is just 15 days from the shock event date, you would have regained your 8%. And from August 8 onwards, any further continuation of the increased rate would have given you even better average returns than 8%. Now this was our simplified version on why losses occur, but why if you continue to hold on and no further shocks happen, you will eventually recover from those losses. Are there any questions that anybody has at this time? So I think Sachin asks how much return we expect from debt mutual funds. Okay, I think that's a question that we have answered. We will please wait till we reach that point. And I think this, what are the downsides? Now I've said that losses occur because of movements in interest rate expectations, but you are able to recover from those losses if you continue to hold on to the debt mutual fund. What are the downsides? I think first downside, obviously, and I think that was a question, there are no guaranteed returns. Unlike bank fixed deposits, mutual fund houses which are governed by SEBI do not allow to guarantee your return. In fact, no distributor will also give you an indicative return. Nobody can give you an indicative return. But you can get a rough idea. Rough idea. Please let me reiterate that you can get a rough idea of the returns from FD rates of similar duration. Your return from a similar duration income fund or a bond fund of similar duration should be slightly higher than the returns from the FD rates. And I'm talking of the pre-tax FD rates. Where can you get those? You can come to sites like Apna Paisa, which carry FD rate comparisons, or you can go to other places as well. There are, you can look at Business Standard. There are economic weeklies that carry, economic dailies that carry these rates. This is a rough idea. Please, this is not guaranteed. Nobody is allowed to guarantee these returns. But this gives you a rough idea of what you can expect. The other big risk, and I think this is a very real risk, is the risk of loss of capital. Now, unlike a bank fixed deposit, if you lend money to a bank, if you deposit money to a bank and the bank in turn lends it to another borrower, if the borrower defaults, the bank still has to pay you back the FD. But in a mutual fund, if you put money in a mutual fund and the mutual fund invests it in a debt instrument, and the person who has issued, suppose they invest it in a corporate bond and the corporate concern defaults on it, then the loss has to be borne by the mutual fund holder. Now, this kind of a loss is very rare. It hasn't happened very often, but in the world that we are currently living in, it's a very real risk. What can you do to reduce this risk? I think one, SEBI itself has well laid out investment regulations, how much maximum money can be there in one kind of industry, one group companies, how much money can you put, inter-scheme transfers. I think it's a well laid out investment regulations that seek to minimize this risk or reduce this risk. But losses, as I repeat, can and have happened. What you can probably do is you stick to short-term bond funds. Now, bond funds only invest in government securities, which by definition don't default. Or you can invest in highly rated. So, if you go to sites like Money Control, or you go to sites like Value Research or Morningstar, for every fund, you'll be able to find out their average rating, the instruments that they invest in, what percentage is AAA, what percentage is AA plus, what percentage is AA, and therefore what is the average rating of the entire fund. I think that you will be able to find out. As long as you stick to funds that are at least average rating is at least AA plus, I think, or AAA, I think, and they are short-term funds, I think this risk can be reduced to a very, very great extent. But I repeat, it is a reducing the risk, not eliminating the risk. So before I conclude, are there any questions? If you have any questions, do let me know. Okay. Are FMPs better than income funds? I think that's a question that has been asked by Pankaj. FMPs are a great product when you know that you need the money on a certain date. In that case, to avoid this risk of a shock event happening, you should go for a fixed maturity plan. If you see the example that we had, if you knew that you needed the money after 2 years, you didn't really care what happened in between. The disadvantage of a fixed maturity plan is that they are not liquid. If for any reason you need money in between, you'll find that very difficult to get. So fixed maturity plans, especially if they invest in highly rated investments, are excellent if you need the money on a specific date. Yes, I think we have a question from Sachin. Yes, Sachin, go ahead. I have unmuted you, Sachin.
Hello.
Yes, Sachin, go ahead. I have unmuted you.
Hello, Harsh.
Yes, Sachin.
Hello.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Harsh, actually, I want to invest. I want to invest in a debt mutual fund.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so any guidance on or how to choose a good debt fund? Actually, I don't know how to choose a good debt fund. So, any advice on that?
Okay, I think three things from what we just saw. First, if you need money on a fixed date, go for a fixed maturity plan. Otherwise, you can look at a ultra short term fund or a short term income fund or a short term bond fund. If you look at a short term income fund, make sure that the average rating of the fund is at least AA+. So I repeat, if you need money on a fixed time frame or don't want to take the risk and don't mind not having liquidity in between, a fixed maturity plan is good. Just make sure that the fund house says that it will invest in a certain minimum rated paper. The second, in any other case, stick to short term funds. They could be ultra short term, liquid, a short term income fund with a high average rating, or a short-term bond fund. I think in this environment, that is the best way to do it. Does that answer your question, Sachin?
Yes, 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 sir. Yeah, thanks, sir.
Thank you. Anybody else has questions? I think Amin Sheikh has a question. No, okay. Sandesh has a question. Yes, Sandesh, please go ahead. Sandesh, I have unmuted you. You can ask your question.
Hi, so there used to be this double index section benefit.
Hello.
Heard of, if you invest in the
can you come closer to the
Hello?
Mic?
Can you hear me?
No, I can't. Can you come a little closer to the mic and then ask?
Hello.
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Okay, so there used to be this double indexation benefit that I heard of just for 30 months starting March. I'm wondering if that is applicable to all the debt funds.
Oh, absolutely. The double indexation benefit is a very major benefit that continues to exist today. We didn't take it in the calculation. To keep it simple, so 10% is the maximum rate you will pay on a long term if you have held the debt mutual fund for at least 1 year. It can be lower because of the double indexation benefit. So I think essentially your tax rate can be even lower than 10%. That's a slightly more complicated calculation and hence was not taken there. Does that answer your question, Sandesh?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay. I think there are questions. That's it. Okay. So, just a minute. I think there are some more questions. Okay. Let us quickly conclude. I think excellent post-tax returns. So maybe the pre-tax returns might be similar, but post-tax returns makes debt mutual funds a good investment option. The tax efficiency of a debt mutual fund makes it a very good investment option. You can reduce the risk of price loss, the one that happened in July 2013. either by investing in fixed maturity plans so that there is no price loss, but then as I said you lose liquidity, or you can short term plans which you continue to hold on. So what you lose during the time when there is a shock, it can be gained back pretty quickly. What you should do is stick to short term bond funds, low risk, both price risk and credit risk, or highly rated short term income plans, and please stick to good fund houses. We have seen this in 2008 that when there was a bit of a crisis in the debt fund industry, that the only one, to the best of my knowledge, only one fund could not make sure that the amount was returned back. All other fund houses managed to make sure that the debt mutual fund investors didn't lose on credit. So I think it is important that you choose a good fund house and stick to short-term bond funds or highly rated short-term income plans. This will help you reduce both the price risk as well as the credit risk. I think with that, we will end this. I welcome a quick word on Apna Paisa. If you have any queries that have not been answered here, please do come to our Facebook page, that's www.facebook.com/apnapaisa, or there is an Ask an Expert section on Apna Paisa which you can use. Apna Paisa also provides financial planning services. You can write to us at fp@apnapaisa.com if you are interested in using those services. Thank you. Have a great evening. And when I end this show, you will have a survey that will come up on your screens. Please do answer that survey, as that will help us in improving this program further in our later webinars. Thank you. Thank you all for attending.